Hello, my name is Gronkthran Bone Inserter of the Meat Slappers, and you're watching SWN. You get.
Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. We're back on a road trip edition. As you can see, I'm not alone, as I just scanned over briefly. Say hello to the camera.
Hello to the camera.
Hello to the camera. Yes, I am in a car, as you can see.
Not a train.
Not a train, not a bus, but a car. And I haven't even said my name yet. If you're listening for the first time, my name is Billy. I'm the host of this show. We do a road trip episode when I'm going to WrestleZone or W3L or wherever. That's the only shows I go to nowadays. So we've got seven matches on the show tonight, WrestleZone Station Hotel Showdown. I'm very excited for the show. This is your first proper one since Regal Rumble last year.
Yeah, it certainly is.
And Kelly's not going to be on the camera because I want to concentrate on the road. I want to get there alive. I think that's probably the best way for it.
Well, especially now we're parents.
Yes, we are. A lot has changed since Regal Rumble last year, of course. Not much has changed since Trinity Centre. Where was Trinity Centre takeover, except, you know, he sleeps. So that's nice. So yeah, there's seven matches on the show. We're going to talk about them for a brief second, get your thoughts on them as well, because it'll be the first time you probably have heard of whatever matches are on.
Okay.
As well. So yeah, Station Hotel Showdown tonight, WrestleZone, can't wait to go back. Sold out show. I'm probably going to double check to make sure I definitely have tickets. I'm sure I do. I remember buying them.
Bloody hope so.
It's going to be very awkward if I don't. So, seven matches. We'll start with the VIP one, which is a triple threat. It's Chris Archer, Ronan King, and Conor Malloy.
Okay.
Triple threat. Should be fun. Ronan King won our One to Watch award.
Mm-hmm.
And him and Conor like smack each other. So, this could be a lot of fun.
Could be interesting.
So, this is your first match back.
Yeah.
We'll be seeing Chris Archer. Conor and Ronan.
Well, the last time I saw Ronan, he slagged off my son, so I hope that he loses.
I think from any matches I've seen with him and Conor, they do like to lay it in. I think that's the phrase.
Uh-huh.
They like to proper get. So it would be the last time we saw the wrestle, Conor ended up with like a busted nose. So
yeah. So
it could be interesting.
Holds back.
Yeah. So the main show, we've got loads of matches, so I'm going to try and remember them. Oh, we did get a question from Ronan. He did ask, how does it feel to go to your first show and see the first show of the year of Ronan 2.0?
Absolutely delighted.
you just want to see Conor Barrow.
Yep.
Yeah.
Do it for me, Conor.
I'm just hoping Conor doesn't land on me. He's getting... He landed on me at Halloween Hijinks, and he came very close to Christmas Chaos. So I don't want that to be a thing,
no.
A streak that happens, because I am not afraid to throw you in front of me.
I know. And now I'm actually attending a show. I don't want that to happen.
So we've got that. So main show, we'll start with the handicap match. It's Omar Mohammed taking on Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker. 2-on-1. So I'm assuming it'll be tag team rules for Dawkins and Tucker, and Omar will be on his own. We don't know if he may find a tag team partner. Of course, you didn't see Scotty Swift. They lost to Christmas Chaos and has now had to leave WrestleZone entirely.
Has he?
He has.
His boots.
Apparently so, yeah. But I mean, wrestling, though, retirements never stick. So we'll see if it actually works out. But yeah, we've got, so Omar is avenging Scotty Swift, and he's got a match against both Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins. I'm very aware that the sun is right in my eyes at the moment, so I look like I'm just being suspicious on camera, just shiftily looking around. So yeah, that should be interesting. I don't know if there's going to be a tag team partner involved, so I might come and help Omar. His uncle's going to be there. You watched Family Fortunes.
Yes, I did.
His uncle, who suspiciously looks like Pete Mohammed, the one at the end with the bald head and beard, he apparently will be in attendance to fly the flag of Omar Mohammed, TV's Omar Mohammed. So I don't know if Pete will get involved. We can only hope, because he's very charismatic. What else we've got on there? So we've got Bruiser Brad Evans against Tommy Raiden. So Tommy's going to die. So that's... I mean, not much more you can say about that.
I have nothing to add to this portion.
So, Bruiser Brad, of course, is coming off a loss of the tag team titles, a loss of the Fair City Saints at Christmas Chaos. He's big, he's scary, he's fast, and he's coming against Tommy Raiden, who had a quite good showing at Christmas Chaos. He was knackered at Trinity Centre, where we saw him for the first time. But stranger things have happened. Connor beat Crusher, so you know I'm highly doubting it, but could be a shock. Could be a shock start off the year. I've got tag team titles are on the line. Fair City Saints, Alex Webb and Ear Miles are defending against Outfit, Dino and Murphy. Should be a lot of fun. Two big lads against two fast lads.
Okay,
good combo. You've seen Alex individually
because he was Alex Webb.
Yeah, he was Summer Hill Showdown.
Yeah,
with the Orange and Black. You haven't seen. I don't think you've seen Air Miles. The only other time you may have seen him, you didn't come to any of the Bucky shows. I don't think, did you?
No.
So you would have seen him before. So something new for you. You've seen Dino and Murphy, of course. Dino. Just big lads smacking the fuck about, which you know,
yeah,
can't go wrong. Don't know who's gonna win that. I hope it's the Fair City Saints. Only won the titles in December, so
hope so then.
I think they would keep the titles for a little bit, but you know, stranger things have happened, and my prediction things for WrestleZone are rarely good. They're pretty awful.
Your track record's
my track record, that's the phrase, that's why you're here. To give me the words.
To be the driver.
And to give me the words that I forget. We've got Caleb. You're wearing your Caleb Valhalla t-shirt.
Whoop, whoop.
He is creating.
So is Jack.
Jack's wearing his Skull t-shirt, which I haven't put it anywhere, so no one can see it. Just assume that I'm right. Just trust me. We've got him. Caleb's putting his beard on the line against Captain Alan Sterling, who is putting his association with Outfit on the line. So Caleb wins, Alan's on his own. If Alan wins, Caleb gets his beard shaved. He's already had his head shaved. So, fingers crossed we don't get him.
I don't want a beardless and a hairless Caleb. That's just wrong.
I know from experience, having no hair and no beard, it's not a combo that you want.
No.
It's awful, to be honest.
It's like one of the... some things from Spy Kids.
It'll be called Kale Thumb Valhalla. No, I don't know. Give it a bit more time, I'll think of something funny. Hopefully I won't need to. So got that. Hopefully Kale will win and Alan is battered. I've used battered quite a lot already on this.
Toot toot.
He makes them hungry. And I'm just thinking of like...
stop thinking of food and get on with it.
I always think of food. What else we got then? So we've got the Tri-Counties Championship. We've got Mickey Vago, the Tri-Counties Champion. He'll be defending against Zach Dynamite, the former undisputed WrestleZone Champion.
Come on, Vago.
So we'll be rooting for Vago, of course, because I hate Dynamite. It's the weirdest thing. Zach Dynamite, I like him. Anywhere else, I like him. Any other time, but between the 3 hours of that show starting and that show ending, I hate him. Unimaginably hate him. I'm so glad to see him lose the title at Christmas Chaos again. Getting smacked with the Darkest Lariat, slightly chopped clothesline thing that the last one does.
Okay.
It's award winning as well, you know, apparently so. So with that, we're hoping Vago's going to win that. What else? I've forgot those. We've got the championship, we'll just go for the Dispute Championship. Don't think there's any more. I probably have forgotten a match. We have the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. It's Aspen Faith defending. Yes, he's defending the title against one of your favourites, the inspirational Ryan Riley.
Okay.
So that's the main event.
Okay.
You like Ryan?
Yeah.
Thought you did.
It's been a while, I can't remember. sorry.
I thought you liked Ryan. Oh, sorry, Ryan. I thought that was...
Oh, I do like Ryan. Sorry. It's just taking a minute.
We're trying to remember which one Ryan was.
Yeah, my brain. I'm so sorry.
Headband.
I do remember you now. Yes. Yes.
So yeah.
Sand through a smoothie.
That's it. That's the one.
For your happy birthday message. Yeah, I know who you are now.
So,
I'm sorry, Ryan. I do love you.
So Ryan will be trying to defend the honour of Foundation of the Future after they lost the title. Sorry, Foundation of the Future.
Losers of the Future.
After they all lost their titles at Christmas Chaos. And if all goes well for them, they'll come out with two belts. They'll come out with the Tri-Counties and the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship.
Well, that would be a good way to lead into the Rumble, wouldn't it?
It would be, but I would also like them not to win.
Yes.
So there's that as well. I was speaking to Kelly about my Rumble predictions, which will be inevitably wrong because they always are.
And your track record precedes you.
It really does. It's awful. It's terrible. But I have written down who I think is going to win. I'll probably put up something closer to the time by five predictions because you know if there's 20 in there and I put out five predictions, well, one in four chance of being right.
One in five.
No, that's 20. I put out five people. One in four.
Okay.
I think it's been 25 last year, maybe about 20. One in four chance. It's like those odds. But that's it. We're going to head to Aberdeen in our car. Maybe I'll visit the train station, see what it looks like, because apparently that's where the North East fans belong. I would need to be in the train zone. Hope everyone's enjoyed our recent episode of Grado. That was a lot of fun to record. 45 minutes of I don't know what we spoke about. I'll be honest with you. I asked him how he balances his work and everything, and 40 minutes later, I needed to go. So that was it. So enjoy it. Hopefully we'll do a part two sometime in 2025 when I can actually pin him down for another chat. But the next bit will probably either be a bit in Aberdeen or that, and we might do a show bit at the end, so this will be a shorter episode as planned, but you know, I'll end up taking a million pictures and do like a 10 minute montage in between. So we'll see you later. Bye.
Bye.
Aberdeen station. We get our train cards here apparently. This is a great bit for the audio content because I'm just like heavily breathing because I've just done steps.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's enough proof to show that we took the car because we're definitely in the car.
Yeah, but it doesn't actually
look like
we're just walking through the train station.
Oh, well, I better stop it then.
To my party, we're just getting started. A life is a dream or a nightmare scarring. Hand me a drink cause I think I'm going all in. Get me a shrink who can catch me when I'm falling. Cover up my scars, flip the handlebars. Crashing in my car, wake up in a bar. I'll be a superstar, just on my avatar. This world is so bizarre, empty out the reservoir. Yeah, taking six shots, yeah, straight to the face. And I wanna get lost, I'm sick of this place. Don't know how to stop when I'm feeling this way. So I'm taking six shots till I'm feeling okay. I think I'm going crazy, don't think I'll get home safe. So I'm taking six shots all straight to the face. I'm taking six shots, are you coming with me? I'm taking six shots, yeah, straight to the face. And I wanna get lost, I'm sick of this place. Don't know how to stop when I'm feeling this way. So I'm taking six shots till I'm feeling okay. I think I'm going crazy, don't think I'll get home safe. So I'm taking six shots all straight to the face. I'm taking six shots, are you coming with me? Sometimes you need to let loose, grab juice, get goose, tattoos, taboos, get screwed. Loosen up, buttercup, all those hate comments will never make you feel enough. We're all adequate graduates, hearts full of calluses, but we know calculus. Damn, ain't that fabulous? Can't wait to apply all those mathematicus. But we can't get a job that pays us enough. I'm about to pop off. Fuck you, you're lost. We all know that we never really want a boss. So I'ma do what I want to. Something I can't undo. Yeah, I'ma do what I want to. Something I can't undo. I'm
straight to the face. And I wanna get lost, I'm sick of this place. Don't know how to stop when I'm feeling this way. So I'm taking 6 shots till I'm feeling okay. I think I'm going crazy. Don't think I'll get home safe. So I'm taking 6 shots all straight to the face. I'm taking 6 shots, are you coming with me? I'm taking 6 shots, yeah, straight to the face. And I wanna get lost, now I'm sick of this place. Don't know how to stop when I'm feeling this way. So I'm taking 6 shots till I'm feeling okay. I think I'm going crazy. Don't think I'll get home safe. Taking 6 shots all straight to the face. I'm taking 6 shots, are you coming with me?
And welcome back to the SWN podcast. Hope you enjoyed that montage. I enjoyed making it. It wasn't one of my biggest ones, but considering in the Christmas Carnage episode I made back in December, there was like 5 different montages, all 3 minutes long. I think we've got a little bit of a good balance there by just doing a 3-minute montage. So the show happened. I'm recording on the Tuesday afterwards. I'm still planning to do some typing. It depends what I forget to speak about in this current section, but we do have some questions that we can answer as well. But we'll go through the card, go through the results, because I had an absolute blast at WrestleZone Station Hotel Showdown. I'm so sorry for the Aberdeen Wankathon that is about to take place. About that whole thing. I don't know how much people listening will know about it, but we did our SWN year-end awards. There was a little bit of just arseholeness on Twitter about it because of who won. I mean, really, all I can say about it is the votes came in, I counted them, I tallied them, I put them out. That's pretty much it. If it's a case of a lot of our viewership, our listenership, our readership are from certain areas of Scotland, then that's just what happens. But when you look through the results, there's no like glaringly like, oh my god, why did they win? For the wrestlers that won, they've been incredibly consistent and have deserved those awards, those plaudits. For the events that won, they were excellent events. They should have won. The ones to watch were brilliant as well. So I can't see how anyone really would have a problem with it, because, you know, it's a vote. That's just what happens. We've been doing this since 2015, and I think this is the first year that it's properly been there's been some like dickishness about it when it comes to the results itself. So, you know, it's just one of those things. We'll just move on and we'll do it next year. We'll do the SWN 100. We'll do that again, which that reminds me, I'm going to have to actually go and tally up December and January's stuff because I haven't done that yet, because I don't want to leave it right to the last minute again like I did this year, because I didn't know how to calculate it this year, and I was just like panicking doing 12 months of results in the space of like a week, which, I mean, there's loads of events. There's been too many, not too many, but there's been loads of events in that 12 months that I try to get results for, tally them, points and all that kind of shenanigans. I've learned how to use Excel almost okay-ishly. You know, a lot of made-up words in this podcast night. So the show itself, WrestleZone Station Hotel Showdown, I absolutely adored the show. We went to the Station Hotel, first time being at that venue. I missed it. Last year was their debut at the event, and it was at the venue, and it was Battle of Nations. And, of course, my son was born 2 weeks beforehand, so there was just no way I was getting to that show. It just was not happening. But I did actually look up train times on the day of it, thinking, oh, I could just get train zone card. I can go there. I can go to the show. But by that point, I think I'd had a collective 4 hours sleep. So I don't think it was happening. And even if I did go, I don't think I would see the end of the show. I'd be asleep. So it was just one of those things didn't go. So went to this year. It's just a great setup because it's right across the road from Union Square. So Union Square is the big shopping center, one of the big shopping centers in Aberdeen. They've got like the Trinity and the City Cliffs and all that kind of stuff. And there's loads of parking, like loads of parking. There's the train station, of course. There's the bus station there as well. So literally, if you're wanting to get to this particular show, there's so many modes of transport to get there. And it's literally across the road. You just come out of Union Square, go past the massive U that's in the front,
cross the road, there's the station hotel. It's so easy to get to. What was weird about it was though was it was lower ring, and I've mentioned before in previous podcasts. I think last time, and possibly the first time I've seen a lower ring was in the Inverurie show. It was the Inverurie show, and it's just weird. I don't like it. It's just too low for me. But you know, that's just my thing. But the guys that wrestled on the show tonight, they made use of it very well. But I have seen lower rings being used, and wrestlers just aren't quite used to it. So when they're doing things like dives, they hesitate, or they slow down their landings to the point where it just doesn't look good. But these guys have clearly used that ring enough times, whether it's in training or it shows that I didn't notice it being a factor with the lower ring. Especially well, considering in Inverurie when I saw it last time, guys like Rhys Dawkins and Bruiser Brad Evans just decked themselves on it. They missed it, or they tripped over it, or what have you. So nobody had one of those moments on this particular show. Also, while we were in Aberdeen, we found out that Captain Al Sterling and Dino of the Outfit were no longer able to attend the show. They were told, for whatever reason, I don't know, speculation would say COVID, but I have no idea. There was an explanation on the show provided by Murphy, so I'll get into that when I get to his match. So there was a route around, a changeover, a change of matches, and to be honest, and I feel so bad saying this because I love Captain Allen, and Dino's great as well. It made the show better. It actually made the show better as a collective event, and I'll tell you when I go through. So the VIP ticket holders match was supposed to be Ronan King versus Chris Archer versus Conor Malloy. It became a singles match. It was Ronan King versus Chris Archer, which it was a really hot crowd. Everyone was just really happy to be seeing some wrestling. First time some of them were seeing wrestling that particular year. Well, that particular, this year at all. They were the first time they were seeing some wrestling, me included. First time I was going to a show anyway. And it was just Ronan King, man. I'm gonna say so many good things about this guy, and he's just incredible. Chris Archer is a really good wrestler. You don't often get a bad match out of Chris Archer. He's incredibly solid. Sometimes his car he doesn't really exude a character. He's not really kind of a big character kind of guy, but his in ring work, there's always something to enjoy, and he always does something really cool. Whether it's he does a great moonsault, he does a great elbow drop. He's just a really solid hand. That's what he is. He's just a great hand in the ring, and he's been in these VIP matches for the last wee while, and he's been wrestling like the younger guys, like your Tommy Raidens, even guys that are a bit more experienced but still on the young side, like Omar Muhammad. He's been wrestling him, and Ronan King is just he's your next guy. He really is. He's your next guy because he's just got everything. He's worked. He's got the character. He's got the physique. He's got the in-ring portion of it. He's got the confidence. He's just a great. He's just fantastic. And I'm so lucky that we have him up in the Northeast. Again, this is terrible because he's going to clip all these little bits or quote these little bits and just be an absolute dick on Twitter about it and just go told you so and I'm the best, and he's going to draw the ire of other wrestlers, but he is just really good. He's just fantastic. He won our one to watch this year, the male category of SWN Year End Awards. I can't deny him as number one. He had a phenomenal 2022, which was his first full year. He debuted at the end of 2021, and he's put in so many great performances with his matches with Mickey Vago, his match with Grado as well. He's just a great wrestler. It's unbelievable. He should be that good. Not the first time I'm going to speak about Ronan tonight, though, on the show. So on the show itself, though, the VIP pre-show, Ronan King defeated Chris Archer. It was, again, another quite convincing win for Ronan King, and Archer was kind of just a little bit dejected. The rejected was dejected, but there's just something about him that just was off. And I said it to Kelly that there's something off about Chris Archer, but I'd spent the last 6 months saying that he was going to turn on Mickey Vago. So I was always in the conspiracy that there's always something off with Chris Archer. But did he? We'll find out soon. So great opening match, great VIP match, I should say, on the show. Again, it was kind of a last minute thing. It should be a triple threat, became a singles match, and I think the match is better for it. I think that one-on-one thing really helped show off Rory King a bit more, and it gave Archer a really good match out of it as well. Again, still something I'm worried about whenever I see a Chris Archer match. I'm not worried about it being a bad match. It's always going to be pretty entertaining. Even with matches I'm not a big fan of, like Arne Anarchy when he was against Crowbar, wasn't my favourite match of the show, but couldn't deny Archer put in as much as he could. He gave it as much as he possibly could to entertain people. So there was that. When I went to the show, I was going to get some new merch. However, Aspen Faith didn't have his card. Well, Emerson Jane at the merch stand didn't have the card machine, but Aspen did, so I'd have to get it at interval. But I did get a new bit of merch. It is the new Aspen Faith t-shirt. I will just stand up and hopefully not break anything like I have previously when I've done this. Looking good. Aspen Faith, first ever WrestleZone Grand Slam champion. It takes a lot to pull off pink and white tie-dye. It really does. And apparently I'm doing it. I'm looking okay. Great t-shirts. Great wrestling t-shirts that aren't black. I'm trying to move into a bit more color this year with my t-shirts because I have so many black t-shirts. So I try to kind of mix it up. I've got a Grant McIver red, still do the wrestling t-shirt. I've got some old Aberdeen Anarchy t-shirts that are purple and things like that. So I'm just trying to get a little bit of color in my life in 2023 and not wear black. Also, because if I wear black and someone throws up on me, it's a bit more noticeable. Milk stains are a bit more noticeable in black t-shirts, apparently. Also at the show, also at the merch stand, if you went and you were accosted by Aspen or Emerson Jane, you got one of these bad boys. A little colouring in, lost by Aspen. Apparently, if you colour it in and you put your name and age on it and take it back for Regal Rumble, you may win a prize. So I will be, I'll be doing that probably. I have no idea what colours to do, though, so... I don't know, maybe I have an idea, but I don't think I'll do it because that would be silly. And the joke will be dead by the time that March rolls around for the Regal Rumble. But you know, I may think of something. So that was it. That was the VIP pre-show. Loved it. Excellent match. Really great match. Rory King being victorious and just being an absolute bastard in the process. There's just something, he hits all the nerves for people. He just, again, I'll get on to a little bit more about that, but he uses phrases and words, and it's like arrogance of youth and all that kind of thing. He'll just say things and people just be like, oh, you probably shouldn't have said that. At least he didn't swear this time, though. So the opening match, the actual show itself, was Caleb Valhalla against supposed to be Captain Alan Sterling. So this is the second match that had to change because of whatever Captain Alan was doing. This feud is just cursed. And I don't know what the conclusion will have to be. And I think in my head, it has to end at the Rumble. I think it has to end at the Rumble when this whole thing started, because this feud just seems to be cursed. Whenever there seems to be a conclusion, it's either someone can't appear at the show, or it's like, just slightly, it's a victim of circumstance on the show, like it was Christmas Chaos, where it just didn't hit the heights it could have, because there were so many matches around about it. There was the emotional thing of Scottie Swift, and then of course the main event as well. So it was kind of put in a really hard position to get the crowd invested. It seems to be cursed, much like Sean Johnson, Brian Tucker was. I want to see it, but I think it may need to end at the next. Either at I don't think it'll end at Ellen, because that doesn't make sense for this big feud to end on what is relegated as a B show, which you should still go to. I can't go to Ellen, but you should still go to it if you can. But it probably should end at the Regal Rumble, maybe. Just in my head, I want Caleb to win the Rumble. I'll get into that a bit more when I've got the questions from Callum to answer. But I'll get into that in a little bit. So this is the first time seeing Caleb in human form, with his bald head anyway, which is a good look, you know, bald head, beard. Excellent. You can't go wrong. And you know what? He looks badass. He does look badass. The thought of him possibly having to lose his beard in the original stipulation would have been absolutely awful, because you know, I know from experience that you turn into an egg, or in my case, I turned into a thumb when I shaved my beard and had my hair cut. It was just not, it was not a good look for anyone. It's not good. It's not look good. It doesn't look good for many people. You have to have a proper good jawline to do it. And I don't know if Caleb's seen his jawline in quite a number of years. So we're not sure how it would look in the light of day. So he got the microphone. He said that he's looking for an opponent. Someone stepped up and out came Conor Malloy. I was like, wow, this could be quite good. Last time Conor and Caleb faced off, it was in a handicap match, and Caleb kind of ragdolled Conor quite a bit. That was, Summerhill Showdown last year? So January last year, so quite a year since then. And this match was incredible. It was just amazing. I said it on a tweet today when Conor put out a little video of him doing a sliced bread number two on the outside with Caleb hitting the ground, hitting back first on a wooden with a thin carpet floor. That this match was last minute but stole the show, because I would say it would probably be match of the night. Personally, I think it was the best match as a match itself. With there wasn't a proper story coming into it. The story was Conor stepped up, and last time Conor did that, it was against Crusher, and we know how that ended. Well, us nerds do. We know how that ended. It ended with Conor getting a win and then becoming a team with Crusher and becoming tag team champions. So to see this match was just so good. It was just they Caleb did all these big muscle man, big cool things. He threw him about. He did all that kind of stuff. Big hard forearms. And all that jazz. And Conor fought back. He kept fighting back. He had the high flying stuff. He had the kicks. He had the dives. He, like I said, using that smaller platform, the lowered ring, he was still able to pull off some really cool maneuvers. He was able to use his environment really well. And it was such a hot match that folk were biting for everything, because there was no stakes. So it was a case of Conor could have beaten Caleb in that particular match. It would have been amazing, but Caleb could have won as well. It would be just as incredible to watch. It was just two good guys battering each other. And it was a great match. Like I say, possibly match of the night for me personally. And I want to see what Conor does next. I think Conor needs to hoping Conor gets into some sort of title contention. I'll get onto, again, a lot of mixed by things I say, and I'll get onto it a little bit. Hopefully I remember. I'm not going to write it down later for a thoughts on WrestleZone Station Hotel Showdown. But no, fantastic. Echoing Adam's thoughts, it was still invested in Caleb versus Allen. This match was probably better than, as a wrestling match, was better than we could have got between Caleb and Allen. I want to see this play back, maybe with a little bit of a story behind it. Maybe if one of them wins the title belt, a little bit of title stakes in there. I think that would be quite cool as well. The next match, it was the handicap match. It was Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins versus Omar Muhammad. And I hadn't said when we were in the VIP, getting ready for the first match of the show, it was for the VIP ticket holder match. It was on there. Not long before the show started, Scotty Swift arrived. Of course, Scotty Swift, who lost a Loser Leaves WrestleZone match in Christmas Chaos, he was there as a fan. He had his it was just weird seeing him in like human gear, like not as a wrestler. He was there. He was in the crowd. He was the was it the Hard Times Farm side or? He was there anyway. He was behind the hard cam because it would have been facing the entrance way. Hard cam, who am I? I'm not Meltzer. So yeah, we had that. He arrived, and of course he was leading the charge with cheering for Omar Muhammad. He gave him a hug before the first match. Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins, I don't know how they've done this, but Brian Tucker, at this time last year, I had little to no interest in Brian Tucker. I think he had a match with Alex Webb at Summer Hill Showdown. So I was like, it's Brian Tucker. I'm starting to get the delusional thing of Brian Tucker. I was starting to kind of get it, and he was almost like the gatekeeper of WrestleZone, but not with so many words. And I was just, when he entered to their song they put out at Christmas, Bye Bye Scotty, to the tune of Bay City Rollers, it was just, the crowd just hated him. And again, I'm going to use Kelly's experiences here, because she hadn't really kept up with what's happening. She was kind of going off what I was saying, so she hadn't seen this video, I don't think. But when it started, she looked at me and went, oh, how dare he? She was even like, oh, Brian Tucker's an arsehole for this. He's the worst for coming out to that Bye Bye Scotty song. And you know what? It's annoying. It's bloody catchy. It's the worst thing in the world, is that it's so catchy that I feel bad about just sitting there just in the dishes, washing Jack's bottles and going, Bye Bye Scotty, Scotty, bye. I feel awful, but it's so catchy, it's ridiculous. They keep threatening an album. I want to see it. I want to hear this album. I don't know if he's got other songs in the back of his head. If he's got something that I am not a Wally, maybe something like that. But I want to see it. I want to hear it. I want it all. I want it now. So the great thing about this, again, I'm echoing with some of Adam's statements here in his review they put out, which is amazing, by the way. He wrote it like hours after the show. He did it while watching the Royal Rumble, and then put out the on the Sunday, which was amazing. I can't. Adam's great. I'm so lucky to have him on the site, doing the WrestleZone stuff. I've also had a really spate of good writers come in recently. I've had Daniel Micah, I'm doing Combat League and Fair City, and I've got Gary McPherson as well doing Reckless Intent and Discovery Wrestling. So I've been very lucky recently when it comes to adding writers to the site. And I've also always got Westy in the back in the wings. She's doing some FPWA stuff and what have you. I'm very lucky to have so many great writers on the site. I loved it that Tucker Dawkins, they're only bonded by their dislike for Scotty Swift and for Omar and in turn Omar Mohammed, because they're not a great team. They kept missing tags, they kept getting things wrong. And the bit that I loved the most was there were so many little silly moments, but it was Brian Tucker suggesting to Rhys Dawkins to do poetry in motion. So we know the move, it's the Hardy Boys, poetry in motion. And Rhys Dawkins shouted, oh, I love poetry. Love it. That's the best thing. And it just made their character so it just made their character three-dimensional, that they're so he's so deluded with this poetry and all the Shakespearean stuff and all this classics and all that kind of thing, that his thought of poetry emotion wasn't the wrestling move. It was literally poetry. And it's just ace. It's just brilliant. I bloody love wrestling. I do. Bloody love it. Omar was just incredible as well. The fact that he didn't get anything in our awards or even the top three of like ones to watch was honestly, for me, was shocking. I think he should have been nipping somewhere. He should have been in some contendership, some match somewhere, some award anyway, because he was so good in this match. He has such a consistent 2022 as well. But the raw emotion of Omar. I was looking to meet WrestleTalk Muhammad, of course, who looks suspiciously like Pete Muhammad from Family Fortunes, to see them offering their support for Omar was so cool. It's so natural, and so there's no fakeness about it. They're not there just going, oh, Omar's doing some of the wrestling, I'll come and support him. No, they're invested in it. They're so into the wrestling. And to see that along with the emotion that Omar was putting out, because for him, this was a blood feud. This was doing redemption for Scotty Swift. This was for fighting for his friend, fighting for just everything, and you felt that in everything that he did. There was just such a tension to everything that he did, and his eyes were like full of fire, and it was just beautiful. It was a beautiful match itself. We got to see the Big Kachowski as well, submission from Omar. Unfortunately, after a little bit of distraction, Reese used his fifth act, Cobra Kutch, leg sweep, and that was all she wrote. But it was the aftermath as well that added to this. That had Tucker confront Swift, who was in the crowd. Swift got heated. This whole thing got a little bit raised. Tucker pushed Swift. You know, you push a fan. That's what he was there to be. He was there to be a fan. And Scotty took off his Ghostbusters Heisman jacket, whatever it is, and revealed Where's Wally t-shirt with Brian Tucker's face on it. And it was ace. I love that t-shirt. I want that t-shirt. It was striped and everything. I said I'm after colored t-shirts this year, colorful t-shirts. So yeah, it was such a reaction that then people grabbed Scotty, grabbed Tucker, separated them. Reese Dawkins didn't hang about. He has no loyalty to Brian Tucker. He left. He didn't even stick around to help Tucker or separate them. He just picked up his book and just left, which adds to the silliness of this tandem, that they're there purely to antagonize Swift and Muhammad. They're not there as a unit or as friends. They've just kind of ended up stuck together under circumstance, which makes it even more hilarious. I didn't know how this was going to go, but I think Omar and just all four as well with Scotty, they made this a really important moment in WrestleZone, made it a really important moment of the show as well. And they caught the emotion just right, as in if it was over emotional, it would have ruined the next match, I think, because people would have been like, oh, so dejected. Like it was, not saying it ruined it, but like it was at Christmas Chaos. I don't think they realized how important Scotty Swift was to a lot of fans at Christmas Chaos. So once Scotty lost and we had that moment of him getting on the microphone and the place just went silent, there was just people were just gutted to see Scotty Swift lose. It hurt the next match. It hurt the Caleb Allen match as well. But this time they caught the emotion just right, where it was, we were just excited or hyped to see what was going to happen next and see where the story's going to go. I've got a million different ideas where this is going to go. I have an idea. I might share with you my terribly predicted Abri Anarchy card that I've got kind of whirling around in my head. I'll make sure that if I've got a little bit of time and I'm not like talking your ear off here, because I'm very aware this is going to be like an hour of me just speaking myself, and you're listening to it, and I thank you for that. So we move on to the next one, the first half main event. We had the Tag Team Championships. It was Fair City Saints. It was supposed to be against the Outfit, Murphy and Dino, but Dino could not make it to the show. Murphy came out and he cut a promo about the situation. He got a bit too shouty for me. I didn't quite understand what he said, but from what I gather, Dino and Captain Allen went to Scandinavia to find Vikings, and that's all I really got from it. But you know, it at least added some story to proceedings. So he introduced his new tag team partner for the evening, and it was Ronan King. And he came out in now I know how this feels, Ronan, but because at Christmas, at Halloween Hijinks, I went in a ladies' leather jacket as part of my Mickey Vago ensemble, and he came out with I would only assuming it's Emerson Jane's leather jacket, but it was really small on him, and it was so tight, and it was like a crop leather jacket, and he's so good. It's so annoyingly good. He came out, he started out, he's got these glasses that have the graphics on it. In the first match, in the pre-show match, it said one to watch. Love you. Love you, Ronan. And this one, it was, I can't remember what it said, tag team drip or outfit drip or something like that. So exactly that. Got the turnbuckle. Murphy looking furious at this whole situation that's unfolded because he's just annoyed by Ronan. And Ronan got up on the second turnbuckle to do some yay and hit his head off the roof. And everyone just laughed. The boy gets it. The boy gets wrestling. And he's like 19. And I don't like how good he is at 19. And I'm terrified how good he's going to get when he's my age, when he's 32. And he's got over 10 years under his belt. And he's just possibly the greatest wrestler of all time. I love the Fair City Saints. They're a great team. They're really, just really cohesive. I love them as a team in general. We've got Ronan was trying to make Murphy do tag team moves, and they were just not on the same page. And I know we had the same, like, that kind of thing happen with Omar and sorry, with Dawkins and Tucker, that not same page thing. But because Ronan and Murphy have such polar opposite characters, it just made for something even better. It just made it so hilarious seeing them try to do it. Ronan King shouting to do Canadian Destroyers and all that kind of thing. And we got Canadian Destroyers somehow. We got Alex Webb doing a Canadian Destroyer to Ronan. We've got Ronan doing a Canadian Destroyer as well. I think it was Ronan. But yeah, we've got Canadian Destroyers going on. We had this really cool step up dive from Ronan as well. Murphy was on the apron, but he was like hunched over. And Ronan ran across the apron, jumped onto Murphy's back, and then jumped onto the Fair City Saints, which was just so cool. It was a really cool match. Like, it was just seeing all these kind of stuff you wouldn't see on a show. If this was the arranged match, Outfit versus Fair City Saints, we would have seen things like these silly things like Canadian Destroyers and silly dives and silly moments, and it was just so good. It was such a good match. It was just beautiful. Another great match to kick. So that's what's that, four matches so far, and I've loved all of them for different reasons, just for little moments and little things like that. But Ronan King, in this first half of the show, two matches, two amazing performances, and I'm so sorry to everyone listening, but this seems to be instead of calling it Station Hotel Showdown, just call it Ronan King is really good at wrestling. Soz for informing you of it repeatedly. I'm going to take a little bit of a break. Someone's woke up, so I'm going to go and put back to sleep. And I'll be back for the second half of the show and with your questions as well. So I'll be back in a moment. And we're back for the second half of the show, and hopefully the questions, unless someone wakes up in the meantime. So second half of the show, first half, amazing. Great show, absolutely fantastic. Every match was just incredible. It was great, great show. Got my Aspen t-shirt at the interval, got a picture with the man himself, which will probably be used to break up these two halves of the show, these two thirds, I suppose, of the show. So I got a picture with Aspen. Kelly got a picture with Caleb Valhalla. So she's happy. She was happy with that, which is always good. And I got to take a picture, and it was finally a picture that didn't blur. You know, it's quite rare when I take pictures of people with wrestlers. It's just sometimes not good at it. Let's kick off the second half about the WrestleZone Tri-Couch Championship, because Mickey Vago defending against Zach Dynamite. And Archer came out with Vago. And again, I said earlier in the show, I was like, there's something off about Archer. Something off about Archer tonight. And I just couldn't put my finger on it. Of course, I'm a conspiracy theory, so it could be anything. I was like, could this be the night? Maybe not. Maybe not tonight. It'll be maybe a little bit later on. No, tonight was the night. So this match was a little bit of a slower-paced one. The first half show matches were just all fast-paced and lots of happenings, a lot of action. But Dynamite and Vago, they created a little bit of masterpiece, a little bit of magic on the canvas, where they took us on a little bit of a journey. We had with Vago and Dynamite just urging each other on to just smack each other harder or just leather each other even more. And it was just more of a case of just two guys, angry guys, just absolutely smacking the living shit out of each other. So yeah, that's what was happening. We had Close calls for both. We had Dynamite could be the three-time Wrestling Tri-Catch champion, with Vega could be retaining. Back and forth they went. And towards the end, Vega tried to use his mist again. I don't know if it actually missed. Here we go, play all words. But the referee caught it. The new referee, was distracted. He goes, my eyes, and all that kind of stuff. Bruiser Brad came out. Bruiser Brad Evans came out right about the start of the match, and he was looking to interfere. Archer came in with a chain in hand, and Brad asked maybe the worst possible question for Vago. Asked Archer, "What are you gonna do?" And Archer just popped Vago in the face with the chain, took off his cut, his rejected cut, put it on Vago's body, and left. Oh, this sound! Right, they put the video on YouTube, so go check it out. The sound when it happened, everyone was like, oh my god. But there was a little, like, gruff voice in the bug stack that you can hear that shouts, yes, that is my voice, because I've been calling for this for 6 months, that this was going to happen, and I was wrong for 6 months until Saturday that it was going to happen, that Archer would turn on Mickey Vago, and we'd get some sort of maybe something in the future between the two of them. I've got ideas for it. But yeah, so when it happened, I was like, oh my god, yes! And then, oh no! Oh, boo! Ooh, this is bad. It was the match itself was really good. It wasn't like full of your big moments. It wasn't full of your Canadian Destroyers or your big flippy doodles and all that kind of stuff, which I love. I love a lot of the time. This was just a good quality wrestling match with the two guys just, like I said, battering lumps out of each other. There was a skull crusher finale on the apron, which looked nasty, right in front of me as well, that happened. So there was just a lot of good stuff in this match. But the match itself, it was a bit of a slower pace and all that kind of stuff, but it was all about that moment of Archer coming into the ring, being asked what he's going to do, and then just laying out Mickey Vago and costing him the Tri-Cows Championship. So we've got Zach Dynamite a month removed, just about 2 months removed from losing the Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. He is now the first three-time WrestleZone Tri-Counties Champion, and big moment to kick off the year for WrestleZone, and that's what WrestleZone do very well, and that is have these moments that you don't forget after a show, and they just emotionally cripple you at the same time. After that, after all that kind of things with Bruiser Brad coming out, he says started back out for his match with Tommy Raiden. Not a lot to speak about in this particular match. And Raiden showed a lot of fire, a lot of character as well. People really get behind him because Bruiser Brad has done such a good job since the restart of WrestleZone after the pandemic of just being a big, nasty bastard. And because of that, folks just want to see him get taken down somehow, and not, I don't think anyone on the roster has done that really yet. Not properly anyway. I mean, they've won the tag titles and lost them to the Fair City Saints, of course, but nobody's really squared up to Brad yet. And I think to see someone like Tommy Raiden, who's a lot smaller, attempt it. Of course, it's not impossible. Connor and Crusher, of course, being an example of when David beats Goliath, but this was not. This is your come down after the big moment. This is your little just a little bit of like a palate cleanser, call it that. We've got Bruiser Brad using a Gotch style pile driver to finish off Tommy Raiden, and just yeah, I thought we may have seen a murder, and wasn't far off, because he leathered that boy, he leathered Tommy Raiden in and about that whole match, however long it was. But Raiden showed play a fight, I think. I think that's going to add a lot to his reactions going forward. He was trying to get fired up, but was getting pushed back by the much larger Bruiser Brad Evans. So it's not a knock on the match itself. It did what it should have, which was make Bruiser Brad look like an absolute beast and made Tommy Raiden look like a really plucky underdog and trying his best to win. So it was a great match. Great little match. It was not the best match of the show, but it was perfect for what it needed to be. I'll say that. It's variety. Shows are variety. That's what that's what it needs to be. Speaking of that, yeah, I think that was kind of Kelly had one criticism of the show is she needed a comedy match for her. That was her kind of feelings, and she went with Alan not on the show. That was our only thing that she was critical about, was that she needed that levity, she needed that comedy, and Ronan King provided a lot of it, but she needed a proper Captain Alan Sterling match, just that little bit of levity for her. But I said she enjoyed the show, but that was like her only one criticism, was she would have liked to have a Captain Alan match, and you know, circumstances meant they couldn't be, so she understood that, but she needed that levity on the show. It's a Friday show at the end of the day. Yeah, so before the main event with the raffle, of course, which Kaylee of K&K Wrestle Factory lost again. She did not win the raffle, unfortunately, but it was drawn by former Undisputed WrestleZone champion Damien, a former tag team champion, etc., etc. So Damien drew the raffle, and there was some bits of banter and all that kind of stuff, a nice little back and forth with Martin and Damien about that. And then Ronan King appeared for the third time. VIP people paid for one ticket, and they got three Ronan King segments and moments of match in general. Lucky people. So we got Ronan in a very fetching bejeweled shirt, black and sparkly, you know, with a cut-off cardigan, turtleneck kind of thing, which, again, takes a brave man to pull off. And zebra print shorts. I don't know fashion. We'll leave that there. So Ronan just basically said Damien was done. He needs to go away. He's old. Go away. You're old. Etc. Worse to that effect. Damien took exception. Ronan kicked him in the leg with his injured hamstring. And that was it. Damien was like, we'll be cleared to wrestle soon. And Ronan will get his comeuppance. I can't wait. I can't wait for that. I think that's a really big match for Ronan. I know he's had the match with Grado. He's had matches with Scotty Swift. He's had these matches with Mickey Vago and Chris Archer, of course. But I think having a match with Damien is going to just push that a little bit further, possibly even in some title contention somewhere down the line. I think that match with Damien is going to be very important to Ronan King. And I think it should be Anarchy. I think that's an Aberdeen Anarchy worthy match, but we'll see what happens between now and then. But I think that gives it plenty of time for Damien to recover from his torn hamstring. Gives plenty of time for it to build a really nice story. It gives plenty of time for Ronan to antagonize everyone possible. I've got a feeling that he might break some records in the Regal Rumble, whether they're good or bad, I couldn't say. I think he's gonna have a showing there anyway, and we'll lead to Aberdeen Anarchy, and we'll see some Ronan and Damien. I think if that's the case, can't wait. Whatever the story is, though, I'm sure I'm going to be invested in it either way. And that led us to the main event. We've got Undisputed WrestleZone Championship. We've got Aspen Faith against Ryan Riley, who had Bruiser Brad in his corner. Of course, Aspen Faith, who has just come off a hot weekend of winning Wrestler of the Year, Move of the Year, part of Match of the Year, part of Feud of the Year. He won our SWN Monthly Poll Wrestler of the Year as well. He's won quite a lot when it comes to our year-end awards, you know. Unfortunately, like I say, Hardy Wagathon, I think that's what was quoted to be called. But it was purely deserved. Personally, of course, I am biased, but I didn't vote my own year-end awards because I thought that's a bit weird if I do that, because there's some sort of bias on there if I do that. I just counted the votes, guys. I just counted the votes. This was just two big dudes slapping the absolute shit out of each other. And that's what Ryan Riley promised in the lead up to the show. And that is what they delivered. They just delivered two big guys just smacking each other. They just leather but chops, big forearms. They just leathered. Yeah, that's it. Leathered each other for 10, 15 minutes. And Brad wasn't there for long, but to be honest, we got three lots of Brad Evans as well. You know, we were spoiled on this show. We got three lots of Ronan King, and we got three lots of Brad Evans. You know, I mean, chalk and cheese when it comes to their physiques and physicalities, but you know, Yes. Get good spread there. So big chops, big clotheslines, lariats, everything you could want with two meaty men slapping meat. That's pretty much what we got as the first defense for Aspen Faith with Undisputed Wrestling Championship. Eventually, Aspen won with the Darkest Lariat and then a Jade Roller. Apparently, I had to go and check. It was called a Jade Roller. Thank you to Adam. I'm not a guy who watched the Briscoes, so I wasn't sure. But thankfully, people told me that it's a Jade Roller, the double arm pile driver. And it was just a really good start, really great start to his reign, to Aspen's reign, just coming in for it was set apart from the rest of the show. Like I say, we had a lot of fast-paced matches in the first half. We had the kind of slowed down, build-up story of the Trikouts match. We had the quote-unquote squash from Evans and Raiden. And then we had this kind of big match feel of two big guys just leathering each other in the main event over the biggest title, the most important title in the company. And they were just throwing hands and just making... Just making it feel like a main event and making it feel like it was just two guys that needed to win. And it was just, it was great. It was a great main event. It was just, if people are resetting for the year and they're going into January thinking, oh, what am I going to do this year? What are we going to do? What are we going to do different? Try wrestling. We'll just do the wrestling. It's a station hotel. We're not ready for the day. We'll go to Nando's, we'll go to Pizza Hut, we'll go Wagamama, we'll go and get some Krispy Kreme donuts, and just go across the road to the wrestling and see what it's all about. And they get that show, it's the best money you've probably spent that day. If you got cheesy bites from Pizza Hut, it runs close, but this is probably still the best money you spent all day. Because there was, the crowd, in Grado. In a recent chat with Grado, of course, on the podcast, if you haven't listened to my chat with Grado yet, please go do so, because, it's probably the biggest guest I've had on the show so far. He loves coming up to WrestleZone. He said himself that the fans understand the stories, they get involved with the stories, and they just embrace the stories as well, and that's what WrestleZone do so well. There's shows, there's promotions out there, and they're great shows, great matches, great promotions, but not many. Not saying all, I'm not saying none. Not many have that through line of story where everyone kind of has a story as well. I mean, you'll have shows that run once a month and they'll have maybe one story running through it. Maybe their heavyweight title story, they'll do that. Maybe they'll have two stories. They'll have their two titles. They've got a story running through it. Whereas it seems to WrestleZone are one of the companies that have this ongoing story for everyone. Like, they've got the Foundation of the Future, have all got something going on, they've all looking after each other, or they've got everything kind of bleeds into another story, and it's so entertaining to watch. And I've used the phrase many times, I'm starting to sound really bitter when I say it, but even though it does turn into an Aberdeen Wankathon when I'm doing reviews of that, it's because I feel the emotions at these shows, and watching them on YouTube, I enjoy shows. I enjoy watching wrestling on YouTube. It's great. And some shows attach myself more than others. I find I really attach myself to like Discovery shows. I think that they just hit my kind of mark most of the time. And some don't. Some just I enjoy the content and I get why I should be enjoying it. But without being in the crowd and being surrounded by people that are showing that emotion, that are roaring with it, that are in the room, it just makes it feel different. And that's why I wish I could go to more wrestling. I end up going to shows that are within a 50-mile radius. That's just how it works. Of course, just between financials and real life stuff. I would love to go to more wrestling and see more shows, but that just doesn't happen. And it does affect what I put out as content, because if I go to a wrestling show, if I go to a live wrestling show, the emotions of the show and of seeing it actually happen, seeing hearing the sound of the mat, walking past the ring and seeing the sweat on the floor and see that kind of stuff. It all adds to the show. It all adds to the experience as well. I have no point to that, the statement that I've just started making. What I will say is, though, if you haven't gone to a wrestling show yet, go to one. Just go to a wrestling show. I'm not saying go to any wrestling show. There's some really shy ones out there. But generally, if they're featured on our site, I will say, if they're featured on our site, not to like toot our own horn here, they're pretty good. They're going to be pretty good. There's some that we don't feature that probably do a good show. But we just, for reasons, I wouldn't recommend them, but you know, check our feature promotions to the site, and that's a good place to start. Anyway, it's a good place to start if you're looking to go to a show, got a calendar and everything. You can go check it out and go find some wrestling, go bloody enjoy it as well. All right, let's go answer some questions then, because I've probably been talking for like 2 hours, it feels like, at this point. We've got loads from Callum, so thank you very much. We did answer one in the first 10 minutes bit when I was in a car from Erling King, who I've talked about so much on this show, because he just, this was his kind of, if this was how he started this year, I am so excited to see where it ends up this year. So Callum's asked a bunch of questions, which, brilliant, thank you. It really helps with me putting out more content, more words coming out of my mouth. I think I need some water, but we're going to do it. We're going to go through it. First question was, who do you think, if there's going to be international talent at Abu the Anarchy? I don't know. It's one of those weird ones. Is, I think they've got, if I've got a kind of card in my head, they don't need an international talent. Would it be good to pull in numbers? Absolutely. It would be really good. I'm trying to think who could be quite good to get in that might not break the bank. But it'd be cool to see like Big Demo come back as well. He's been at the shows before, as when he was part of the wider Scottish circle, of course being Irish, but he pretty much is part of the Scottish wrestling circle. That'd be quite cool to see Demo come back. Of course, he's been WWE, he's done stuff with Sanity, he's doing stuff in Progress now, appeared in AEW. That would be interesting. I don't know who I'd put him up against, though, because in my head it would be like, oh, I want to see him against like a Caleb, but I've got other plans for Caleb in my head here. So I don't know. If I was going to get someone up, I'd want them maybe somewhere with Zach Dynamite, maybe. We had that stellar match with Pac back in 2019 at the Beat Leisure Centre. So I think something like that with the Tri-Counties title, maybe, that could be interesting. That would be quite cool. That would be something. But I honestly don't know. They could probably get away with not having a guest like they did last year, and they had a really incredible show and didn't have international talent or an import or anything like that. I know Mickey Vago's desperate for an import, though, so, you know, maybe we'll get Bill James back. Right, rest of them. Did we see potentially a setup for two of the Abu the Anarchy matches on Saturday? Yeah, I think we did. We saw a setup for Damian Ronan King and for Mickey Vago against Chris Archer in some weird fashion, wash pit rules, wherever. I think that's two matches you can kind of not put a lock on, but I think they're going to happen at Abu the Anarchy. As well as other ideas I've got going on, I've got, let's see, if we don't get an international talent in, Zach Dynamite, Conor Malloy, Tri-Counties Championship, give me that on the show. I want it so bad. Who's the fave to win the Rumble? My favourite is Caleb Valhalla. I think that's his next step. Of course, he won the FCW Heavyweight Championship down in Perth. And he's had quite a few matches recently with Aspen Faith. And I think Rumble, he needs to beat Alan at start, go into the Rumble, win the Rumble, Ariarki, Caleb Valhalla, Aspen Faith, there's your money. There is two big dudes that are going to just launch each other and throw each other and just beat each other for however long they're going to beat each other for. I don't know who wins from that point, though, so I have no idea. But that would be what I would want. Another match I have in mind for Abdi Anarchy, leading on to the first question there. Well, the second question there was, I would love to see Omar team with Johnny Lyons to take on Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker. And if they win, Swift's reinstated. If they lose, Omar's gone. You know, something like that. So that'd be cool. That'd be nice. That would be really a great, big emotional match as well on the show. So we've got that. And of course, I think that's probably, we're probably going to head to Fair City Saints and outfit somewhere, form or fashion. They might just delay that a little bit longer and have that happen at Anarchy also. So I think we're shaping up. In my head, we're shaping up to for a really, really great card for Anarchy. But they always are. They always are really good shows. So it would be no shock to me if none of those matches happen, but I'm still loving every match that happens. Question four. What did Murphy actually say the reason Dino wasn't there? Something about customs? I don't know. Did Alan try to take something from somewhere from Scandinavia? I didn't get it. I didn't hear. I want to say that, yeah, I want to say Captain Alan tried to take something from Scandinavia and he couldn't get through customs. We'll take it from that. Five. Brian's still a Wally? Yeah, he is. Yeah, he's still a Wally. But once he's come up, but he's got a really catchy song. Damn him. I had last question that he sent in. Thank you very much, Callum. How much more of his mother's clothing is Ronan going to have to wear when Damien finally kicks the shit out of him? I don't know. It depends how hard he kicks him. He might have to wear some Spanx. I don't know how to answer that question, but I'm looking forward to hopefully seeing Ronan and Damien clash. Like I say, hopefully at Anarchy, that would be my hope and prayer. But if it's at Rumble, I'll be there for it as well. So just as long as it's not at Ellen, then I'll possibly see it. I don't know if they'll do a show between Rumble, and it might be an Academy show maybe between Rumble and Anarchy. Hopefully do something like that. I want to do Keith again, just because it's really close to me. And I can take my brother to it. And maybe we'll be able to take Jack to it as well if they come to Keith. That's close enough for me to go and not worry that something will go wrong as well. So maybe. Not that I'm saying please, but you know. Oh guys, go on. My train zone card gets there. So that's it. I've talked about the show of I'll say it one last time. Yes, it's been an Aberdeen Wankathon. And I have had an absolute blast talking about the show. I don't think I've missed that much. I don't think I'll do. I might still do a thoughts on post, but I think I've covered most of the points. Like I say, there's so much that Adam put in his review that it really, it was a lot of me echoing those thoughts and then adding little bits here and there. But the show was an absolute blast. It was so funny though going through Station Hotel because it looks quite fancy when you go inside. It's quite nice and all that, and you're walking through the dining area to get to the hall, get to the function hall, and it's just seeing people just watching this mob of people in wrestling shirts with signs and all that kind of stuff all wandering through like a big screen of folk and going through to the function hall. So that is quite hilarious. Only other thing before we go, congratulations to Dennis Law on the birth of his daughter. I've panicked for a moment, but daughter. Hopefully, when he comes back, he has learned how to count better. But we love you, Dennis. Thank you very much for everything that you do. Even taking our stick as your for your refereeing skills. But no, it's been great. I've had a great weekend considering we're going into this show with just the farce of Blobby Blobberts being a dick. We had that happening. The wrestler made up for it. The company made up for it. I hung out with Kelly Kaylee again, of course, of K&K Wrestle Factory. Always a joy. Kelly got to go to her first show, proper show since Regal Rumble. So she had a blast, and it was just a great weekend. So I think I've done enough. I think I've talked enough now for this episode. So hope you've enjoyed everything that we do here at Scottish Wrestling Network. We do try our best to make it as entertaining as possible for you. You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/ScottResNet. You can find us on Twitter at ScottResNet, and Instagram's the same at ScottResNet. But most importantly, the website, swnscotland.com, where we'll have all our news, reviews, interviews, and everything in between about Scottish professional wrestling. And with that, I'm going to go and have a big glass of water and probably go to sleep. So have a good one, and good night.